If you like this podcast, you're going to really like McClanahan Academy. Head over to McClanahanAcademy.com. That's McClanahanAcademy.com. Enroll. It's free of charge. You get a free class, 10 Myths of American History. When you do enroll, I've got nearly 20 classes there available for purchase. Go to McClanahanAcademy.com. Enroll today and get a real history education. The Brion McClanahan Show, episode 713.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to have you back in the program. Very glad to be here. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter, like my Facebook page, and subscribe to my YouTube page where you can watch this podcast. Find all those social media accounts on my webpage, brionmcclanahan.com. That's B-R-I-O-N, McClanahan.com. While you're there, give me that email address. I'll give you a free ebook, Forgotten Founders, free audiobook of the same title read by yours truly. You can support the show by going to McClanahanAcademy.com. It's always free to enroll. Get that free class, 10 Myths of American History, when you do enroll. And, of course, purchase one of my courses there, or 20 of my courses there. And I've got a new course out. It's a new kind of class at McClanahan Academy. It's McClanahan Academy Live. You're going to get me live. You're going to have on-demand content, plus you're going to get me live four times. I'm actually going to talk about that class today based on an email I received last week. So you're going to want to get that class after you listen to this podcast. I can guarantee it. And I'll talk about some dynamics with it and some other things. So go to McClanahan Academy, buy classes there. It keeps this podcast free of charge. You can also click on the support tab at brionmcclanahan.com. You can throw a few pennies my way. Click on the heart button under this video if you're watching on YouTube. That's the super thanks button. You can throw a few pennies my way that way. Or, of course, you can always go to the shop tab at brionmcclanahan.com, get my logo and all kinds of cool stuff. But as always, one of the great ways to support the show, and again, it's free of charge, is to rate, review, and subscribe to the podcast. Leave that five-star review. Leave a comment on YouTube for the algorithm. Do all you can to promote the product. Share it around on social media. That's how we grow the audience organically. And let me tell you something. A lot of podcasts out there that are showing huge numbers are not organic podcasts. They don't have a lot of real growth. We do on this show. You're a part of that. And I say we. It's not just my show. It's your show. And I want to talk about that this week as well. I'm going to have some listener-generated content this week. So this is your show as much as my show, and I want you to be a part of it. So send me those show requests, too. I do appreciate seeing what you want me to talk about. All right. Well, let's talk about the topic of the day, and that is this new class at McClanahan Academy, McClanahan Academy Live, Causes of the Civil War. Now, I want to start with an email I received last week about that class. I've had it out for about a week now. I'm only going to open it up for a short period of time. So if you want to jump on the class, and let me tell you, one of the great things about this class is you're not going to have huge numbers of students in it, okay? And I did that on purpose with the price point. I'll talk about the price point. But this is an opportunity for you to have more access to me and interact with me on a pretty small class size basis. I mean, it won't be hundreds of people in this class. So you're going to be able to ask me questions directly. You're going to be able to have me answer your questions right then and not wait or send me an email and hope I respond because, I mean, look, I get a lot of email and a lot of time. It would take me a lot of time to respond back in detail and all these things. So this is an opportunity for you to have access to me on a regular basis four times over a 6-week period. We're going to cover a really cool topic, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit and how important it is to understand this and how this email led me to think about, well, maybe this is the perception of what I'm doing in this class, but it's completely wrong. So let me get into the email first, and then we'll talk more about the class. This is coming from, I'm just going to read the email. He says, I'm a fan of your Founder's Guide to the Constitution, which, of course, I wrote in 2012. So he read that book, and great, read the book, fantastic. Thank you for reading the book. I consider it to be my best book that I've ever done. Nine Presidents is fun, and it was funny. How Alexander Hamilton Screwed Up America is great. But the Founding Fathers' Guide to the Constitution really does set out, I think, the best argument you can make for originalism that can be made in a single volume. He says, I used to be a neo-Confederate sympathizer myself. Now, what makes you think I'm a neo-Confederate sympathizer? What does that even mean? So he's using terms from the beginning that would strike me as a little bit odd, right? Somebody that, this is what you get in these emails. Somebody sends you an email and they say, I am a big fan of yours, but and I used to be a neo-Confederate sympathizer. Well, that shows me right there that this is probably, and there was a follow-up email to this. I believe it's a left libertarian, right? That's who this person is, a left libertarian, which isn't really much of a libertarian. But anyways, a left libertarian. So I used to be a neo-Confederate sympathizer myself, and then I read all the primary documents, all the primary documents. Now, that's an amazing contention that you read all of the primary documents. I've spent years. Now, I've had a PhD in American history for nearly 20 years. And in 20 years, I can honestly say I've not read all of the primary documents on the war. It'd be impossible. All of the primary documents, you've read everything? Everything. I've read a lot of them, but everything? Okay. And he says, it became pretty obvious that the war, for the South at least, was about preserving the ability to extend slavery westward and retaining their control of the government. All right. So here he sets out, he gives me his opinion on what he thinks the war was about. Now, this is from an email that I sent. Was the war about slavery? Was the war about slavery? We're not talking about secession. We're not talking about the sectional conflict. We're not talking about any of that. Just the war itself. Was the war about slavery? And this is why the class is entitled Causes of the War. Right? So it's called, and I'm going to tell you what I mean by that in just a minute and why you're going to want to take this course. So causes of the war. Was the war about slavery? And he's saying, well, the war for the South was about preserving the ability to extend slavery westward. Now, I did a podcast on this topic years ago. Years ago. It was probably, you know, five years ago, something like that. And the title of that podcast is Why Slavery. It's one of the best ones I've done. And I explain why slavery was an important issue in this particular period of time, why it was an important issue for the South, and why it was an important issue for the North. I think if you downplay the institution of slavery at all and say, well, it didn't play a role in anything, well, then you're a liar. But on the other hand, I think if you make it into a moral crusade, and see, what this particular person is doing is simply regurgitating the slave power thesis. If you make it a moral crusade as one side was insidious and all they wanted to do was go for power, and the other side, the way you paint that picture is there's a false dichotomy. One side is power hungry, and the other side were just a bunch of altruistic, good, righteous people just wanting to stop this heinous institution of slavery. But we know that's not the case. We know that the North looked at this as a power play as well. So if you've taken any of my classes at McClanahan Academy, if you've listened to me for any amount of time, you know this is exactly what I say all the time. The sectional conflict was about power. Who was going to control the general government? Now, I will say this about the South. They were simply concerned about controlling the Senate. They wanted to, or at least having equal representation in the Senate. And why? Because they were always concerned that the North was the power-hungry section and wanting to monopolize the reins of government and control of the political economy of the United States. And ultimately, yes, there was some concern that that would lead to the extinction or the abolition of slavery in the South and the places where it already existed. But as Davis points out, and I've got a great class coming up on Jefferson Davis in just a few weeks, as Davis points out, well, I mean, this was not really about extending slavery. It was about diffusing slavery. It already existed. We're not going to do anything. We're not going to increase slavery because we take it into the Western territories. It's diffusing in his mind. So we're taking slaves from one state and putting them in another place, but that doesn't mean it's going to increase. So extending slavery, it's a little bit of a wrong word, but certainly they wanted to have more slave states. There's no question about that because they thought that could protect their political economy, which, yes, in many cases for the large planters was dependent on slave labor. But you had a number of Southerners, in fact, the vast majority of Southerners who didn't own slaves, and they were still engaged in the cash crop agriculture that the South had, right? And there have been studies, at least one really good study on this, that Southerners Even if you remove slavery from the per capita data from the South, we're more wealthy, we're wealthier than the North, right? So there's a whole lot of stuff going on here. And I find it fascinating that people would regurgitate the slave power thesis without really knowing that that's what they're doing. But on the other hand, having a board in their eye when they say this, well, the South is just power hungry. It's the slave power. Well, what do you think the North is doing? Charles Sumner, and this is what I did in the Radical Republicans class, Charles Sumner is on the record for saying what he wanted to do was make America New England. Now, is that not power? Is that not one section trying to control the reins of government? Is that one section trying to retain control of the government for themselves? Well, of course it is. And we know New Englanders talked a lot about this. This is why they wanted to secede as early as 1794. Right? So this was always about power. It's Michael Holt's thesis, if you get the political crisis of the 1850s. But I'll talk about that in a minute with the class, because this is the key part of the class, okay? So then he says, I'm not going to pay $500 for what strikes me as likely cherry-picked, fanciful propaganda. But I'm certainly curious. What's your strongest piece of evidence that the territorial slavery question wasn't the primary cause of the war? When did I say it was, number one? But when did I say it wasn't, right? When did I ever say it wasn't? Or when did I say it was? I didn't say anything about that. But here's a guy wanting me in an email to condense down for a class that I'm going to go through all this stuff just to give him the answer. It strikes me as very odd that people would actually have the hubris to think that I would do this. Okay, but the thing is, he's not going to pay $500 for what strikes me as likely cherry-picked, fanciful propaganda. So he's assuming, you know what assuming does, that this is what I'm going to do in the class. So let me explain what this class is going to be like. Because, again, you're going to walk away from this class with a better understanding than this guy about the different interpretations and positions of the war. Because that's exactly what we're going to do in the class. We're going to start in the 1860s, and we're going to start with different interpretations of the war. We're going to talk about the variety of interpretations of the war. That's why this class is going to be so cool, because you're going to come in and you're going to get hit. Maybe you have a belief in the slave power thesis. I'm going to give you the other side, and you're going to get it in ways that I don't think you ever have. Or let's say you believe in the arguments against the slave power thesis. You're going to read the slave power thesis. Maybe you're actually going to be like this guy and walk away and saying, well, I think the slave power thesis is correct. I'm going to give it all to you. So for example, we start in the 1860s in this class. And we actually, there's a speech that I did in the Copperheads class at McClanahan Academy by Clement Vallandigham. I'm going to include it in this class as well, and I'm going to have you read a part of it again. If you never took that class, that's okay. If you took it, you're going to see it again. And that repetition is important for getting these things into your mind, these arguments there. You see, Clement Vallandigham in 1861 was making arguments that would be called lost cause arguments today. Vallandigham was laying out a position of the war where he made slavery an incident that led to the war, but not the cause of the war, right? This is exactly what people like Jefferson Davis or Alexander Stevens would say after the war is over. So the first section of the class is entitled The Lost Cause. And I have you read, and I'm not going to tell you what you're going to read yet, because I want you to get in the class so you can see, but you're going to actually go through and read much of the documentation, some really, really good stuff about how people argued or the Southern position, the lost cause position of the war. But it's not just Southerners who said this. There were Northerners saying the exact same thing during the war and immediately after the war. Not just Southerners, but Northerners. You see, the lost cause position is in many ways the Democrat position both before and after the war. It didn't matter if you were a Northern Democrat or Southern Democrat. They were pointing out the inconsistencies in the Republican Party and what they were saying about the conflict, and they were deep diving into what the real motivation was behind these people who are making slavery such an issue. It wasn't some moral altruism for the plight of slaves. No, it wasn't at all. It was about power, and they made this very clear in their arguments that they laid out about the causes of the war. So, we're going to read that stuff. We're going to go through and read the lost cause material, and this is what this individual saying, well, I used to be that neo-Confederate sympathizer. That would be a neo-Confederate sympathizer, somebody that reads the quote-unquote lost cause material, which is now all called propaganda. Did these people lie? Were they making this stuff up? Were they being inconsistent? Was Jefferson Davis being inconsistent in 1890 from what he was saying in 1850? Well, clearly not. And again, we're going to have the Jefferson Davis class later on in October. You're going to get that. That's going to be released. So he's not being inconsistent. In fact, the lost cause position is the same exact thing Southerners and many Northerners were saying before the war even began. So we're going to look at that, right? We're going to look at this whole entire school of thought that's known as a lost cause. Then the second unit, we're going to talk about the slave power thesis. Now, we covered some of this at McClanahan Academy in the Radical Republicans class. But we're going to go into depth, into detail, on some of the individuals that were writing about the quote-unquote slave power thesis. And one of the interesting books that I have you read was actually published, or parts of the book, was actually published in 1862, and it was published by a Brit. Not an American, but a Brit. And the amazing thing about this particular book is that he's attacking the positions that many times are associated with the neo-Confederate sympathizer position. For example, he goes after the argument that tariffs caused the war in 1862. So that would mean that people were talking about this. Now, the amazing thing about that is that you would have people like Eric Foner or Sinha, some of these historians, they would get, you know, when the judge was attacked on the Jon Stewart show, right? Judge Napolitano for saying slavery didn't cause the war. And you have a panel of historians, including Abraham Lincoln up there, right? And you've got these people on there that, I mean, they're clearly just so excited to be on TV. I mean, they look dorky, right? So the judge is up there. It's him against everybody. And you have Eric Foner sit there and say, well, nobody was really talking about tariffs in 1860. Nobody was. Nobody was. Nobody was talking about this at all. Well, that's an amazing accusation to make when a Brit in 1862 will actually, in a book, refute that thesis. Why? Because people were talking about tariffs in 1861. Because people were talking about an economic conflict in 1861. This is the amazing thing about it. So what's happening here, when you get through this class, you're going to realize that all these things these establishment dorks say, right, are just simply not true. That there is a lot of people saying X, Y, and Z, but you see, it doesn't, that complicates, it muddies the water. It makes things not so clear-cut. It's good North, bad South. Pro-slavery South, anti-slavery North. We know that's not the case at all. Now, you do see there are people that try to have complexity, but they still have to fall back on the slavery caused the war position because you can't do anything else nowadays. Because if you don't say that, then you're some kind of neo-Confederate sympathizer. You see, this is what happens. This is why this guy that wrote me this email has fallen into the trap of the establishment. If you come up, if you say, well, look, wait a second here. What about, you know, this, this, and this? This is why Gary Gallagher, when he wrote his book, The Confederate War, he said, well, wait a second here. What about this, this, and this? He said, I'm worried that people are going to call me a neo-Confederate. I'm not. In fact, Gallagher has gone out of his way now to make it clear that he doesn't really sympathize with the South because he was worried about being called a neo-Confederate sympathizer. Think about what's happening with that kind of stuff. It's so pervasive and so stupid that if you say anything that will be considered in any way of refuting the slavery caused the war thesis, you're a neo-Confederate sympathizer. And that's a pejorative. You can't think anything good about the South. There's nothing to be said about the South that's good. These people were just all bad. Now, that's shocking in a lot of ways, because you see, it wasn't always that way. It wasn't always that way at all. But what we've gotten because of people like Eric Foner is a very narrow view of what American history has to be. And I'll give you an example of that. When I was in graduate school, I was taking a class, a reading seminar. And that's what this class is going to be, by the way, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But it was a reading seminar, and the professor brought up, and it wasn't Clyde Wilson, it was another professor at South Carolina, brought up a chart, and he said, look at all the interpretations of Reconstruction before Eric Foner. And once we get to Eric Foner, everything narrows to race. Nothing else is talked about but race. You see, Eric Foner did exactly what he wanted to do, and that zeroed the focus of everything in Reconstruction on race. Nothing else mattered. And his point was, and this is his point in saying this, was, look, we've destroyed historical inquiry. Because you can't say anything else now and hope to get your articles published, hope to get books published. You have to bow to this kind of interpretation. So we have this slave power thesis where slavery caused the war. It has to be slavery. It's all slavery. This is the 1860s into about the late 1800s, same time period as the Lost Cause, 1860s into the late 1800s, 1880s, 1890s, in that area. We're going to have reading that goes along with this slave power thesis. The slave, you know, the South trying to control the government. It was all about power for the South. And these just poor Northerners were just being subjected to these awful Southerners. And we couldn't do anything because these terrible Southerners were just abusing us. That's the slave power thesis, right? So we have the Lost Cause we're going to cover in a unit. We have the slave power we're going to cover in a unit. And we're going to look at their arguments. Do they make sense or do they not make sense? Were Southerners concerned about the status of slavery? Well, clearly they were. But what does that mean? So we're going to go into those two things, right? And of course, my biases are going to come out in this. I'm not a big slave power thesis person, because I think that's, again, putting a plank in one eye, because you're not seeing that what you're trying to do is control the other section. And then we're going to move forward into what's called the reconciliationist school. We're going to look at that. And essentially, that the material I have you assign you in that particular unit, we'll talk about how in the early 1900s, late 1800s, really late 1800s, early 1900s, you had this period of reconciliation. It's what David Blight talks about in his book, Race and Reunion. And he says, this is terrible. It's terrible because what happened was Southerners decided they cut a deal with Northerners. All right, we'll recognize Abraham Lincoln as a great American. Look, slavery was wrong. Secession was wrong. It's illegal. They basically just capitulated on that issue. It's illegal, even though the arguments really hadn't changed at all. But we'll say secession was illegal. Lincoln's great, but you're also going to recognize Southerners as noble and just and fighting for a cause they believed in. And at the time, they thought this was right. And so we're going to recognize Southerners, people like Lee and Jackson, as real Americans. And these people are going to be accepted and welcomed into American society. And generally, the history of this period of time, this reconciliationist school, falls into that position. You've got a clash of cultures, a clash of economies. This is the Beardian thesis that we'll get into. This is Frederick Jackson Turner. This is all that stuff in this early nationalist school. You had these variety of things that caused the war. Slavery, just as, this is why it's called, you know, this is why people say it's ridiculous, because slavery is seen as an incident, not as the cause. Certainly they talk about it, and they'll say things that are, you know, slavery is important. They never discount that. That's the thing. Even the Lost Cause people, quote unquote, they never say slavery wasn't important. They all do. Everyone says it is. It's an important issue. But why is the real question? Why? Why is it important? Is it a moral crusade against the immoral people, or is it something else? That's the real question we're going to answer through all these historians as we look at this. So the next unit is this nationalist, this reconciliationist school, as we talk about this coming together, this consensus on, well, you know, the North had good things, the South had good things, but now we're one United States again, and we can all agree on these general things about the war. Really not much has changed, except that we've left off the part about the South being good at all. That's what's happened in the last half of the course, but I'll get into that in a second. So this reconciliationist school had a number of very prominent historians involved in it. And when I talk about prominent historians, these are some of the big names of the late 19th, early 20th century in America. These are some of the people that really defined the new profession in American history. These are people that were professional academics. They were professional historians. They were concerned about sources. They were concerned about the methods. These are things they're doing. They're out there collecting the data, collecting the evidence, and they're writing about it. Now, not all modern historians like how they did this stuff because their conclusions often don't point in a direction modern historians would like. So that's the third part. We're going to talk about the blundering generation school, right? Which is the next part of the class, or another part of the class. The blundering generation school, which is people like Avery Craven, and even moving forward into the modern era, people like Michael Holt and David Goldfield, who wrote a book entitled America Aflame. These are blundering generation people. In other words, what we had in the 1850s was a group of people who blundered into the war. The war didn't have to happen. There was no irrepressible conflict. There was a repressible conflict. It could have been avoided. The war didn't have to happen. And these people often blame the North as much as the South for causing this war. You see, that's sacrilege. You can't say the North were the bad guys. And that's exactly what this guy in this email, this is what he's saying. Well, the North, essentially you're implying the North are the good guys, the South are the bad guys, because he's regurgitating the slave power thesis. Or there's another thesis to this too that I'll get into in a minute. So these people would say, well, I mean, the war was avoidable. Lincoln could have avoided war. Stephen Douglas didn't have to present his Kansas-Nebraska Act. All of this could have been avoided. There were Southerners that were willing to compromise. There were some Northerners willing to compromise. Why didn't people listen to these people? So it puts a lot of the pressure back on the Republican Party as a cause of the war. Why was the Republican Party so unwilling to compromise? Why was Abraham Lincoln so unwilling to compromise on the territorial question? And they do bring up the territories, right? I mean, this is, yeah, it's there, right? We got this territorial question for years. People had compromised on this. Why, though, by 1850, why were Northerners unwilling to compromise, or by the 1840s, unwilling to compromise on the slavery question? Well, what does that come down to? Power. Because what ultimately has to be said is, yeah, I mean, they're opposed to slavery extension. There's a racial element to that, too, which even Eric Foner points out in one of his books, a strong racial element. But it also comes down to power. The North wanted to control the general government, because if they can control the general government, they can get their tariffs, they can get their banks, they can get their federally funded internal improvements. Heck, Calhoun even said this. Hey, we're going to lose control of the government if we don't give these Westerners federally funded internal improvements. They got to have it. If we can just give them that, they're not in favor of tariffs and banks. They don't like any of that stuff, but we'll give them the federally funded internal improvements. That way they stay on our side. And we just have a nation of farmers. A union of farmers, I should say. A union of farmers, rather than what happened after the war when you have this Hamiltonian system foisted on America. This gives rise to the populists, who were more than willing to side with Westerners, South Texas, Midwest, South, an alliance, a farmers' alliance against the big banks and big business and big railroads of New England and the Northeast. You see, it all comes down to economics. What happened was the North was able to use a slavery issue to break this alliance between farmers. This is part of it, to break the alliance between farmers, because Western farmers didn't want blacks in their states. They didn't want any competition. Heck, even David Wilmot says this. I'm not concerned about slaves. I could care less about slaves. What I don't want is black people around me. I want to have this land for free white people. And if we have slaves go out there, that doesn't leave that for us, right? This is going to be a land of miscegenation. They said things like this, right? We're going to have these problems. So it's very racist, what we consider very racist today in what the Republican Party was trying to do in the Western territories. We know that. So then there's the blundering generation. We didn't have to have war. There could have been a compromise. Heck, we had the Crittenden Compromise on the table. Why didn't Lincoln agree to the Crittenden Compromise? It would have ended the conflict. There would have been no war. The war would not have happened. You had Jefferson Davis on the Committee of 13, willing to agree to the compromise. You would have had a majority of Republicans if Lincoln told him to do it, and there were some Republicans who were interested, perhaps, and maybe some compromise, but they were told, don't compromise, by Abraham Lincoln himself. What would have happened had the Crittenden Compromise been favored and, of course, agreed to by Congress? I'll tell you what would have happened. The Republican Party would have died. There would have been no Republican Party anymore because the issue would have been settled, completely settled. It would have been done. It's off the table. I mean, and I'll give you a current way to look at this. One of the things that's happened with the Dobbs decision is that that issue in some ways for conservatives, you could say it's kind of off the table now. They can't really run against Roe v. Wade anymore because it's been overturned. So now they have to shift their focus in a different direction. Well, we're going to have, you know, national legislation on this. But the left is still running on it because they're saying it was an illegal Supreme Court decision, illegitimate, all these other kind of things. But for one side, it's kind of off the table. For years, they were able to capitalize on this and raise money and say, if you elect us, you vote us, you get us in there, well, this is what we're going to do. Well, they did it, and now they don't know what to do about it because the left has come out, and it looks like, at least from perspective, that they're gaining more political capital off of this than the right. I'm not so certain about that. But this is what's happening, right? So if extension is off the table, well, then the Republican Party goes away. So we're going to talk about that blundering generations school. We're also going to talk about the neo-abolitionist school. The neo-abolitionist school, which took, essentially, it's the neo-slave power school. So this would be people like James Oakes. We're going to talk about James Oakes and Kenneth Stamp. We're going to get into some of these people that would put slavery back on the forefront of what caused the war. And there's a number of them, and we're going to talk about these people and how their arguments differ, if at all, from those arguments that were made in the period that's the slave power thesis. How are they different? Are they different? Do they have anything new to offer on the subject, or are they simply just trying to put this back in the forefront that, nope, slavery was the most important issue? And there's a very interesting journal article that people will point to by James Oakes that I'm going to give you in this. If you don't know, James Oakes is one of the foremost war scholars out there. This is, you know, James McPherson. This is James Oakes. These are these kind of people. So we're going to read, and you notice that most of these people are the establishment today. Eric Foner, James Oakes, James McPherson. I mean, this is it, right? So we'll talk about that. We'll talk about the Charles Dew book in the class, you know, Apostles of Disunion. We'll talk about these books that you need to know about, and you're going to know what they say, and if you don't agree with them, how to refute those books, okay? So those are the things we're going to do, and I'm going long on this podcast because I really wanted to sell this class to you. We're going to talk about all of this stuff, and I'm going to go into detail on all these things in pre-recorded, on-demand material, and then you're going to read the material, and we're going to have a reading seminar. We're going to talk about all this material live. You're going to be able to come in with your questions, and you're going to ask me directly, and we're going to have a discussion because the class is not going to be large. We're going to have a discussion on these things, and this is the price point. I know $500 is a lot of money, but let me make this put this in perspective. If you were to take this class from me at, say, University of South Carolina or University of Georgia, or take your pick of any university, you're going to pay 4 and 5 times as much for this class, maybe more, to take it. You're getting it for a bargain, right? And it's not going to be any different. You would get really not much more out of me if you took it there in a short period of time than if you take it here. There's going to be a lot we're going to discuss in these 6 weeks. It's only 6 weeks. It's 4 sessions, at least an hour and 15 minutes, depending on how the discussion goes, and 4 sessions. It's going to be great, right? So you're going to have me for a good amount of time, and it's all going to be, when I say on Zoom, it's not going to be a Zoom webinar where you can't have direct interaction. You're going to have your camera and your microphone on, and you're going to be able to talk with the fellow students. You're going to be able to talk with me. This is going to be a real collaborative class, which is why I put the price point where I did on the class, okay? So it's going to be an amazing class, and you're going to want it. So when people are disparaging and say, well, it's $500 for me, no. You're going to get the whole picture of the causes of the war. It's why I call it the causes of the Civil War. I even use the term that I don't agree with in the title of the class, because this is how we kind of think about it in modern American society. If you've taken my work class at McClanahan Academy, the on-demand work class, you'll know that you'll get my position on the war. I go through the whole thing in detail. But here, we're going to go through all the different interpretations. We're going to review all of this stuff. It's a deep dive in a way that you are going to want. And if you have it and you know these things, no one will be able to argue with you on social media, your whoever it is, right? Your enemies, you have a conversation about the war with your friends, whoever you're talking to about this thing. But most of these times, these things now happen on social media, right? And you get these long threads. You're going to be able to refute all of what they're saying. Okay, so you're regurgitating this position. Okay, so you're regurgitating this position. Okay, so you're regurgitating this position. When they come at you and say, well, you're just a lost causer. What does that actually mean? Define that for me. Can you define the lost cause? Well, you'll be able to when you're done with this class. You'll be able to define what the lost cause means. And are you really, I mean, what, that's a pejorative. Is that even an accurate pejorative or an accurate statement? I don't even think people know. They say, I was a lost causer. I was a neo-Confederate sympathizer. What does it even mean? That you would say that, well, slavery was the occasion of the war, not the actual cause of the war? That there was something longer and more pronounced than this? If you've read all the secession documents or all the primary documents, you'd already know that because it's out there, right? I mean, this is stuff that people said even at the time it was being done, right? So it's simply just laughable when somebody says that. But anyways, that's why this class is going to be so good and why you need it. And these live classes, again, give you that opportunity to have access to me. And if this goes over well, we're going to do more of these. I can't say we're going to do more because I don't know how this is going to work. And it is, you know, time and energy on my part. On-demand classes are the same thing, but on-demand classes you get whenever you want. To actually have a specified meeting time with me is a real benefit to the live classes and why you should go ahead and get them. Now, again, the coupon, you can use the coupon code CAUSES. The class is normally $700, but I'm selling it for $500 because I want you to enroll in it. So use the coupon code CAUSES. Go to McClanahanAcademy.com, click on Causes of the Civil War, use the coupon code CAUSES. I'm not going to run this thing forever. Enrollment for this class closes no later than October 14th. It could close earlier depending on number of students and what we're doing. I want to keep the class size small. So you want to jump in on it and you want to use the coupon because you can get that $200 off. I'm giving you $200 off the class right now. Use the coupon code CAUSES and I'll see you tomorrow on the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.